No one is an island, entire of itself. Everyone is a piece of the continent, a part of the main. If a cloud be washed away by the sea, Africa is the less. As well as if a promontory were, as well as if a household of thy friends or of thy own were. Any person's death diminishes me because I am involved in humanity, and therefore never sent to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. Don't you know that all of us who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were therefore buried with him through baptism into death, in order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of God, we too may have a new life. If we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly all be united with him in his resurrection. Morena, ke modisa wa me, ga nkitla ke tlhoka sepe. O rudisa moya wa me. Eya, le fa ke ralala mo mogogorong wa morutu wa lesho, ga nka ka boifa bosula bope. Wa tla o bankanye bojelo fa pele ga me mo ponong ya bo ba e leng baba ba me. Ruri molemo o tla ntshala morago le boitumelo le botlhoko bo ka matsatsi otlhe a botshelo jwa me. Come, let us sing together hymn 258, Jerusalem Ikhaya Lam.
Oh, Come, let us pray. Please be seated. Gracious God, your love holds in its embrace your children in this world and the next. Neither life nor death can separate those who trust in you. Unite us to yourself, together with our sisters and brothers, that in one fellowship with you, we may be one with those we love. Give us courage, constancy, and hope. Let us confess our sins to God. Lord, we have sinned against you through our own fault in thought, word, and deed, in what we have done and in what we have left undone. Hear the good news. You are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Christ is risen.
Hallelujah.
It is not always easy, Lord, to live that statement. Not always easy to believe when it's preached by old men in dark suits, with faces from which the joy has long drained away, like color from a well-washed shirt, hardly remembered. Not easy to believe, living in a Good Friday world. I can believe in the cross. The headlines in the paper shout its truth every day. The suffering, the pain, Christ mocked and crucified afresh. I stand with Thomas, unless I see, handle the evidence, find hard-edged proof, Lord, open my eyes. I catch a glimmer of the resurrection, like crocus pushing through snow. Purple on white, still cold. I see a gleam of life in daffodil gold, warmer round dark trees. And suddenly I see the resurrection splendor in human courage, in love, in the painful, glad acceptance of uncertainty, the joyous living of today in the shadow of death. In lives touched by your hand, transformed, turned triumphantly to face your light. The stone rolled away, the tomb empty, life ahead beginning now. Lord, give me courage to reach out and take it. We sing Babuetso Sezulu.
God's people, let us find our scripture reading for tonight from the Gospel according to St. John chapter 20, and we'll be reading from verse 1 to verse 23. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciples and the one whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in the place by itself. Then the other disciples who reached the tomb first also went in and saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scriptures that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, let me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." Lilizwi lenkosi leli, uNkulunkulu makalibusise manje kuze kube phakade. Amen.
Good evening, brothers and sisters in Christ. I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. It is indeed a privilege to welcome you to this annual Connexional Memorial Service being held this evening both physically here at the Bedfordview Methodist Church as well as virtually. And by last night's tally, we know, Madam Presiding Bishop, that we had a global audience who joined with us in worship and prayer. This evening, we wish to acknowledge the members of the Connexional Executive who are in the Zoom platform, and especially the bishops who shall be participating in the act of remembrance as they will light the candles in memory of those presbyters and deacons who were members in their synods. This evening, we also have joining us virtually on the same Zoom platform, the family members and loved ones of the ministers and deacons who have passed since the last conference. And to them in particular, we wish to extend a very warm word of welcome as we are this evening able to join with you as you mourn the loss of even those whom we too mourn for as the Methodist Church in Southern Africa. We want to welcome also the circuit members of those circuits in particular where these ministers had lovingly labored and served and who were loved by all those who were under their care. It is you all whom we wish to welcome into this memorial service this evening. We continue in our act of worship as we sing together the hymn, Blij bij mij hier, terwijl die donker nacht al dichter wordt, en hou oor mij die wacht.
Thank you.
The congregation may be seated. We join together our hearts now in prayer, even as we would prepare ourselves to hear the reflection on God's word. Let us pray. Loving God, who brought us to birth, help us to live as those who are prepared for death. Enable us to hear your message of death overcome and life renewed, that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity through Christ, our risen Savior. Amen. Madam Presiding Bishop, the members of this congregation, virtual and physical, it is our privilege to welcome amongst us he who will be sharing God's word with us this evening, the Reverend Paul Verryn, the former bishop of the Central Synod. Welcome amongst us, sir, as you speak not only to us, but in particular to those who have lost loved ones in the past year. Welcome.
Let us pray. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. As we come to this moment of reflection, before I speak on the passage that was read to us, it's important for us to recognize that as solemn as this moment is, it is also a moment in which we remind ourselves of the heritage that the Methodist Church gave to the world, which was that when they were in the presence of death, there was a deep, deep sense of celebration. And so particularly for those of you who still mourn, we want to celebrate the gift, the legacy, the wonderful leadership of those whom we will remember tonight. Many struggled very, very deeply in fulfilling their huge calling given to them by Christ. And yet they remained faithful. Yet they remained an invaluable gift that cannot be measured in gold, not just to the Methodist community, but to everyone whose lives they touched. And so if we can just in a minute, a moment, be quiet and celebrate that huge gift. We also come to this passage in John's Gospel. Now, we're a strange community, let me say to you. And we're strange because one of the things that is absolutely central to any memorial or any funeral in the Christian community is the contradiction which we proclaim as followers of Christ. So, what we say to people is what you see physically is not really true. There may be a box, there may be the presence of death, but in some way, as the Christian community, we proclaim resurrection. And when you read through the four Gospels, you'll see that the writers struggle with that reality in different ways. So Mark's Gospel really comes to an end with no answers. An empty tomb, a stone rolled away. And that's where the Gospel ends. You'll know that Matthew gives us the empty tomb, Jesus meeting with his disciples and giving them the instructions to go into all the world. Luke's Gospel, the empty tomb, the journey with the two on the road to Emmaus, the instruction by Jesus to wait in Jerusalem until the Spirit is given. John has the fullest account of the resurrection. And what happens in John's Gospel, and I've just chosen the first piece of that recording, is in the longing and in the complete immobilization of the early community, Jesus comes amongst them. In some ways, it reminds me of the father who watches for the prodigal son. And when he's still a far way off, he runs to meet his broken, disobedient child. And so the disciples run to the tomb, and all they met with is emptiness. And then the question, who are you looking for? Luke's question, I think, is one of the most incredible questions. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. And then Mary, outside the tomb. What does this new hope look like? What does resurrection look like? Is part of resurrection found in our complete emptiness? Can we only find resurrection in the places where there has been death, our death, any person's death diminishes me. Therefore, do not send to know for whom the bell tolls. It tolls for thee. And so one of the suggestions is that we become resurrection people as we search. And never stop searching. Never. There's a strange way in which we never reach this destination because we search. We search for resurrection from the dead in our grief. But we also search for resurrection in those places in our relationship where there is death, where we just go through the formulations with no sense of reality. We search for resurrection where societies are being humiliated and broken, and although they're alive, they're dead. The whole theme of who we are as God's people is a people searching into death and being met by Christ in that place of emptiness. Why are you crying, Mary? Tell me where you have put him, and I will find him. I can never read that passage without thinking of the gardener in Genesis 1. And here the gardener comes again, looking for us. Then the second thing that we come to terms with, that we've got to come to terms with, is that Christ comes amongst his disciples, and there's a strange marriage here that happens. The marriage between death and life. Jesus comes through the locked doors and into their fear and shows them his hands, and then instructs them, after he has given them the peace, to go into the world and be his witnesses. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you. And so we discover resurrection when we become the witnesses to resurrection, when we speak about resurrection, when we struggle with our doubts. Then we begin to start opening up the imagination of new life for people. I do not think, frankly, that faith comes from being smug about all the things that you find in the creed. I think that faith is born from those places where we are vulnerable, where we are scared, where we are inadequate, where we are broken, where we haven't got all the answers, where we don't cover up our insecurity with falsehood. You would know, those of you who grieve, that in fact, when you're at the place of grief, people mustn't say to you, "Don't cry. It's not so bad. There are others who've gone through this. We understand. We understand your pain." There is a dimension of loss that leaves us with no quick answers. There is a place into which one goes when one grieves that doesn't just snap out of the way because you sing a lovely hymn. In actual fact, our grief, true grief, completely disables us. And it is something that we all wait for. At this moment in the year, the Jewish traditions of Sukkot means that you take all your belongings and you move out of your house and you pitch a tent in your yard. And the symbolism of that is that our life is not permanent. We are journeying through this place. We will meet with death where there are no smug answers. And so for those of you who feel the sting and the pain of your death at this time, may you discover the Christ standing amongst you with compassion and with insight, not wanting to shiver you along out of other people's discomfort at your complete brokenness, but enabling you to rest in your disability and find in Christ's insight a friendship with death. And then finally, Jesus says to them, "Peace be with you." Now, what is that about? That also comes from the Jewish tradition where the greeting was shalom. And shalom was a prayer. And the prayer meant the complete wholeness of the person that you were greeting. And so you see, when Judas comes and meets Jesus and kisses him, and Jesus says to him, "Do you betray the Son of Man with a kiss?" Do you actually come and use that instrument to manipulate these people into arresting me? And I can never read that, "Peace be with you," even though it's not how John describes the betrayal, without immediately being reminded of Judas. And so we come and we gather as a family here, and our prayer is for peace for those who are bereaved, so that the slow dawn of resurrection may come upon those who have lost so, so deeply. And that from that place, they may become empowered to speak about the Christ who has overcome death in resurrection. May we, as the community of Christ, recognize that in this place of complete contradiction, we stand and say to the world, death has no more dominion, authority over us, because we have transcended from death into new life in Christ. Amen.
In silence, let us reflect on that deep word of hope amidst our pain that has been shared with us this evening. As indicated earlier on, this is our annual memorial service, which is normally held during the sessions of conference. And of course, this year, we are very, very mindful that due to the regulations as a result of the COVID pandemic, some of our brothers and sisters in the ministry had passed on, and their funerals were held under those strict regulations, meaning that despite the tradition of our past, not many of us were able to be physically present. This evening, we hope that even as we join together as a connection, that we would have an opportunity now to remember them with deep gratitude for their service and a deep sense of thankfulness to God for having called them as we celebrate their lives, their work, and their ministry. The presiding bishop will be in the act of remembrance now, lighting a candle here in memory of every minister in the connection. But at the same time, in the Zoom conference platform, where the members of the Connexional Executive and the families of the ministers and deacons who have died are meeting, each bishop has received the appropriate number of candles for their synod, and they will light a candle there on that platform. We wish to inform the family of our deceased ministers that your local bishop has been requested to, at an appropriate moment, to hand that specific candle which bears the name of your loved one to you as a family as an act of our solidarity with you, not only now, but a solidarity that will end the day when all of us shall see Jesus face to face as they do now. And so I invite the presiding bishop, who will then light at the appropriate moment a candle for each of our deceased ministers. I invite you, even if you are joining us virtually, if you have very, very loving memories of those whose names are called, we ask that you stand where you are in solidarity of our act of gratitude to God for the life and the work of these our brothers and sisters. And the bishops will do so appropriately at the same time as the presiding bishop does. Louis Bosch. Maylene Coventry. Mandla Gamede. Otso Lesia. Norman Madlala. Jack Maguire. Nkululeko Makula. Doreen Mamputu. Stephen Matsaneng. Malibongwe Mbalo. Isaac Tseko Muketsi. Selo Mohale. Andrew Motsenhyani. Nathaniel Mkeke. Simpiwe Ngobo. Zibangele Nyogonyoti. McFarlane Paniti. Tembile Pimpi. Hermans Ranghaka. Sukumile Sibiya. Dalton Sithole. Kingsley Thomas. We stand together. Crucified Saviour, save us from the fear of death. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Risen Lord, raise us to glory. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Gentle Shepherd, bring rest to our souls. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lamb of God, grant us your peace forever. Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Son of Mary, bless those who mourn. Lord, have mercy. When human voices cannot sing, we bring our grief to you, O God. Set free our spirits from all fear. And let the light, the Christ light, show. Make real for us your holding love. The power to move the stone of death. And let the one we love now go to travel in the Spirit's peace. And so we continue as we sing together, Kena Le Modisa.
please be seated and let us pray. O God, the giver of life and the conqueror of death, we bring into your safe presence those who mourn, those for whom words feel empty at the moment, those for whom the distance from their loved one never resolves itself, those for whom the loneliness, the emptiness gnaws at their souls. We pray for those, Lord, who in their grief are angry and who feel betrayed. Sometimes feel betrayed by the church, sometimes feel betrayed by friends, sometimes feel betrayed and desperately, desperately furious with life. We pray especially for those who really can't see value in going on, for whom days and nights drag on ceaselessly. And we pray that in your mercy and in your compassion, you would enfold them in your kind presence. We pray especially for those, Lord, who carry hurts. And so we come to this place and we say, for those whom our loved ones have offended, today we decide to close that chapter for them, so that they may journey in peace. And for those who have offended our loved ones, we come to this place and seek closure and forgiveness, so that we may journey in peace. We pray for your church, the Methodist Church of Southern Africa. And we pray, O Lord, that you would give to us a diligence in our care of your creation, in our deep respect of one another, and particularly at this time in our history, for the women of our community. We pray especially, Lord, that those who lead as presbyters and deacons may constantly be motivated by the power of your love to teach, to heal, to restore the lost, the broken, the forgotten. We pray, O Lord, that you give us the mind of Christ that is able to penetrate to the reality of truth and in your truth to find our freedom. Protect us from being obsessed with things and regulations and possessions and obsessions, and set us free to sacrifice our lives for you as you have done for us. Teach us, good Lord, to serve you as you deserve, to give and not to count the cost, to struggle and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labor and not to ask for any reward save that of knowing that we do your will, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
We will now bring the service to a close, and after the singing of the hymn, "Thine Be the Glory, Risen Conquering Son," our presiding bishop will lead us in the closing prayers, and then lead us in the benediction, which will be said in our own mother tongues, wherever we are. But on behalf of the presiding bishop, and the members of the Connexional Executive, we wish to thank everyone who has joined us in the service this evening, especially recognizing the families, and thank you for coming along and being a part of this service. Our thanks too to our organist and to those members of the choir who have come to help us in our worship this evening. Reminder to the members of the Connexional Executive that we meet tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock in the morning. The registration will take place from 7:30. And then to invite you again, our members of the Methodist Church of Southern Africa, as we move from the end of one generation, moving into another generation. Tomorrow morning at 8:30, the Connexional Executive, on behalf of the conference, will be receiving into full connection those who have been declared ordinands for this year. And so tomorrow morning, a very special service as the presiding bishop, on behalf of the Methodist Church of Southern Africa and of the conference, will be extending a virtual right hand of welcome to our ministers, who will then be ordained at regional ordination services at dates that have been so determined. We also invite you then to share with us in the closing ceremonies, which will also be broadcast live, and that will be at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening. That will be done from the Methodist Connectional offices in Broome. We sing together, "Thine be the glory, risen conquered Son, endless is the victory Thou, O death, has won."
Thank you.
Before we do the concluding prayers, I just want to make this apology to the Methodist Connection. Yesterday, somehow we failed to meet the regulation of leading services that is happening at this time. There has been changes as levels have been going up and down, and we failed yesterday on the social distancing. We failed yesterday on singing, doing everything with our masks on. And there was a concern that we modeled something that is wrong, and there will be confusion in the connection. Let me say then that as I apologize, before the end of next week, we will communicate with all the ministers as to what is the latest regulation. The confusion has been that since we have come to level one, there is or there has been a conversation that singing is allowed during the services, but with masks on. And so we went with that, but where things went wrong was in the social distancing for the choir yesterday. So I want to take responsibility for that. To anyone who's offended, there was no reason to break the rules from the Connexional office. It was just the understanding that we had. But we will confirm with the SACC the latest regulation, and all ministers will be informed so that there is no confusion. I still want to thank the choir for leading us and being with us during these 2 days, and the organist, thank you. Let's come then to our closing prayers. Bring us, Lord our God, at our last awakening into the house and gate of heaven, to enter into that gate and dwell in that house, where there shall be no darkness nor dazzling, but one equal light. No noise, no silence, but one equal music. No fears, no hopes, but one equal possession. No end, no beginnings, but one equal eternity. In the habitation of your glory and dominion, world without end. Amen.
Amen.
Choice.